Well, hello everybody and welcome to Lunch Break Live. Real talk about obesity, food addiction, recovery, and what's really eating you. I am Carrie De La Cruz here with you again on a Monday. Let's see. It's actually calmed down out there. I always have to talk to you about the weather because it's Southern California and the weather makes news around here. It was a really hot one this weekend, humid, but it has calmed down today, thankfully. And so I guess we are entitled to a few more weeks of spring. That's what I'm hoping. Anyway, how are you guys doing? Did you all have a nice weekend? How you feeling? Life is good. Oh, hey, by the way, I wanted to thank you very much for the additional shares on the program on Friday where we talked about fake it till you make it. Believe it or not, the additional little shares, maybe even one or two shares, is pushing the message out there exponentially to exponentially more people. So thank you guys very, very much for your willingness to do that. It doesn't take much, but boy, it really pays dividends. So thank you very, very much for that. I really appreciate it. So let's see who's here. Let me put my glasses on before I launch into it. Hi, Mama. I am glad that you're here. I see all the hearts floating by. Yvonne, hi. I haven't seen you in a while. And Christy and Dorothy and Jerry and Trisha Ann. Welcome, welcome. Come on in. Hi. Make yourselves right at home. Boy, this sounds like it's going to be a very interesting program today. At least I hope it is. I have no idea really what I'm going to talk about, but I think love is a big subject. I think that one really resonates with a lot of us for a lot of different reasons. Hi, Bonnie. Really glad that you're here as well. So I mysteriously entitled the program The Language of Love today. And first of all, I guess, show of hands or a show of hearts or thumbs up. How many of you guys have heard of The Five Love Languages by Gary Chapman? If you guys have heard of that, you know, that's the best way to do it. Throw some hearts out there because it is love after all. And I know there's a little lag time here with Facebook. So familiar with it? Okay, well, maybe I have a fresh audience here. Hey, my mama, the Walmart greeter, is there welcoming everybody in. All right, so if you are unfamiliar with it, okay, I see a thumbs up floating by. Hey, Stacy, glad you're here. Now the thumbs up are starting to roll by. And a little heart from Trisha Ann. Thank you. Okay, so The Five Love Languages by Gary Chapman. It's a book that he wrote many, many years ago. And listen, I do not claim to be an expert on this stuff because I am not. I am not a marriage or family therapist or anything else. But I think that, I have had a little bit of experience with love languages. How very, very powerful these are because I'm a lover. I kind of spent my whole life being a lover and a drama queen, as you've heard. I think they might go hand in hand. Very romantic. Always romantic. My prince would come on the white horse and the whole thing, and I was always very much in love with love. And I just kind of figured that everybody was in love with love. And I figured that everybody would be demonstrative and would communicate, convey love the same way that I do. Right? And boy, what a shock it was to learn that I can say things till I'm blue in the face to let people know that I love them. But if they don't speak the same love language that I do, they are not going to feel it or hear it. Some of them may say, oh, that's nice. But guess what? The same thing holds true for me because my language, which I'm going to explain here momentarily, I may not hear things that other people who love me are trying to tell me because I do not speak that language. For example, let's say people, buy gifts for me. Well, that's nice, but I don't feel it maybe exactly the way they intend it because that's not my love language. So let's talk about this a little bit. I was going to marry JFK Jr. No, I wasn't. I didn't think he was that handsome, Mom. I was not. So, all right, Greg, I will catch up with you, or you catch up with me, whichever comes first. All right. And enjoy your lunch for your birthday. Yes, happy birthday to you. That's right. Okay. So, as Gary Chapman explains it, and by the way, if you want to learn more about this, take a little online test, figure out what love language you speak. Go to 5, like the number 5, 5 love languages with an S on the end, 5lovelanguages.com. You can take a little test. And there's also newer ones there about your apology languages, how you hear apologies, receive apologies, right? And there's one other one. So, all right, let me just briefly explain them to you because they really mattered. Hi, Rebecca. Oh, I'm glad you made it. And Elisa, hey, welcome, welcome. All right. And yes, as Christy pointed out, we can have several love languages, but traditionally speaking, there's a primary language that we speak, even though we may take the test and find that our numbers are very close or even tied. There tends to be one language that is primary for us. So in other words, we could be fluent in many love languages. So for example, like Spanish and English, right? I may be able to speak Spanish, but my primary language is English, and I feel the most comfortable communicating in English. Okay, so different categories. 5 are words of affirmation, acts of service, receiving gifts, quality time, and physical touch. And you guys have heard me mention these before, and I think, you know, it was such a secret that was revealed to me several years ago, and I just realized how profoundly powerful it is to be aware of the fact that not everyone speaks the same language. So don't worry, I'll explain what each of these categories means, and then I'll explain to you kind of how they work in my life and why I'm talking about them. Hi, Leanne, so glad you're here from New Zealand. All right, so talking about the 5 love languages here from Gary Chapman. Okay, so yeah, the apology one, and then there's one other one that I can't remember, but anyway, I'll get back to you on that. Okay, so when we're talking about words of affirmation, okay, the person that speaks that love language, they use words to affirm other people. So, and if someone affirms them, they feel loved, right? So words. But if we're talking about acts of service, those people feel that actions speak louder than words. So if I do something for you, it's because I love you. You know, whether I'm, you know, mowing the lawn or changing the oil in the car, it's because I love you that much, see? Gifts, these people feel most loved when they receive a gift. Well, likewise, many of these people also love to give gifts because that's how they feel loved when they receive a gift. So they give gifts and receive gifts, and that is love, all wrapped up in a nice bow, right? Quality time, we're talking about undivided attention. Quality time, that means that I am 100% yours for the asking, for the taking, okay? I'm not thinking about anybody but you. I'm focused on you. I am with you. That's one of my love languages. I love that. And physical touch, okay? So physical touch, nothing speaks more deeply than appropriate touch. So you know how some people, and there are times, boy, where I just can't get enough of one. I just want to saddle up next to him and just, I just need to touch him. And my best friend Jan is that way with her husband. She has to pet him. He's very furry. And she's just got to rub up against him. And she just loves that. And that's how she consumes him. And she feels very, very loved. Okay. So my 2 primary love languages are words of affirmation and quality time. And as I mentioned, one of Juan's, my husband's, love languages is acts of service, okay? So we don't speak the same languages. We don't speak the same love languages, certainly, and we also don't speak the same communication languages primarily, but we have learned to communicate English and Spanish, Spanish and English, of course, and we have also learned to communicate in loving ways that we can each hear, and I think that's very important. It is not perfect, but it helps, because again, I am not completely fluent in Spanish, but I can communicate in a way that I can be understood. Maybe not as deeply as in my primary tongue, but I can communicate that, all right? But this takes time and it takes practice and a willingness to learn someone else's language. What do they speak? What makes them feel good? What makes them feel loved, all right? So if you think about it, I am someone who loves to say, I love you. Oh, that's like the ultimate word of affirmation to me. And I tell Juan that all the time, all the time. I just, oh, I love you. Oh, I love you. It means the world to me, right? But just because I say I love him doesn't mean he hears that he's loved, okay? He doesn't hear it the same way that I am giving it, because if it's said to me, I would feel it that way. But to him, it's like, oh, that's nice. Okay, but it's not really speaking to him, okay? He actually feels more loved when I acknowledge his acts of service, the big and the little things, okay? And he does them a lot, whether it's washing the dishes, you know, or, he changed the shower head in my shower because I got a new one. And he surprised me so that when I went in to take a shower, I would have this wonderful stream of water on me, you know, and I make sure not to take that for granted now. You see, I used to go, oh, isn't that nice? But I wouldn't say anything about it. Now I've learned, oh, I have to acknowledge that he did that and tell him how very much I appreciate it. That was such a surprise. That's so nice. I love my shower head. Thank you, babe. Thank you for doing it. That was so sweet of you to do the dishes. I was going to handle those. So thank you so much for doing that. Oh, that was sweet of you to empty the cat box and take out the trash. Oh my gosh, that is not my favorite thing in the world. Thank you so much. I really appreciate that you did that. So just taking that acts of service in other words, just letting him do nice stuff for me. Oh, isn't that nice that I'm letting him? But I have to let him know I acknowledge and recognize it, and that closes the loop on it. Then he understands that I heard that he loved me. Do you see what I'm saying here? So whose fault is it if one person expresses love the only way they know how and the other person doesn't receive it because they can't hear it? Right? Okay, well, here's a hint. It's no one's fault. It just is. It's just the way that it is because we are all different. We say things differently, we hear things differently, we receive and give things differently, right? Okay, so, you know, Juan's primary language, Spanish, okay? He learned English. Yeah, for me. A lot of it was for me. And he doesn't always know how to say things exactly perfectly, super clearly. He's pretty darn good, though, I gotta tell you, after almost 30 years. I mean, wow, his English skills are remarkable, especially compared to my Spanish abilities, okay? And I, you know, I would say things differently as a primary English speaker, okay? But the good news is we have learned to interpret and understand each other's languages, both the love languages and the communication languages. Got it? Okay. And it's very tricky. I understand. It is very, very tricky. But in order to learn, like if I were to speak Spanish to someone who doesn't speak Spanish, or I were to speak English to someone who doesn't speak English, that's nice. They might see the smile on my face, or they might be able to watch my hands moving and I can point at things, but they're not going to understand me, okay? So they're going to receive that, oh, I look like I'm lost, or I look like I'm happy, or I look sad, or I look angry, but they're not going to know why I'm mad. They're not going to know where I'm trying to go. They're not going to understand why I'm happy. Do you see what I'm saying? So it's very important for us not to just assume that the other person that we're talking to speaks the same language we speak. Now, I am not really today talking about relationships with your spouse or your loved one or anything else, because again, not a marriage family therapist, no kind of counselor here. I am really going to be talking about the relationship with yourself and maybe even a little bit with food, okay? Because for a lot of us who come here to talk about this stuff, talk about recovery from obesity or food addiction, food was our primary relationship even before a healthy relationship with ourselves. We treated food the way we should have treated other people. Or maybe we mistreated food the way we mistreated other people. It's hard to say. All right, so think about this for a minute, okay? If my primary love language is words of affirmation, then that means I feel loved when someone tells me I'm doing a good job. I'm a good wife, a mother, I'm special and worthy of commendation. I like to win awards. I like to have my name called, okay? I like to be remembered. So that's what that means. That's what I hear. So words of affirmation whisper sweet nothings into my ear, and I'll whisper them into your ear, okay? So if I show love to others and feel love from others using words of affirmation, then wouldn't it follow that to feel loved by myself, I'd have to use words of affirmation? It's kind of obvious, isn't it, right? That if that's how I feel loved, when someone shows me through their words, affirms me, values me, tells I feel loved, well then wouldn't it follow that I should be doing that to myself? Shouldn't I? How many of us have issues with self-esteem? How many of us struggle with that and say, I don't feel like I'm worthy. I don't feel like I have value. Do we understand our love language, and are we speaking to ourselves in the language of love that we can hear? Well, for me, you know what that looks like? And I guarantee you, for 40 plus years, 45 years, I didn't do this. I learned to say things like, Carrie, you are worthy. You are talented. You're special. You matter. You're a good wife and a good mother. I'm not more special than anybody else. I'm not better than anybody else. I'm not more worthy. I'm not, okay. But I'm talented, or I'm funny, or I say the things that I would want to hear from other people. I say them to myself, but you have to make sure you listen, okay? So it's really important to understand your love language so that you can communicate with yourself lovingly, and you could start to build up this area of deficiency, you know, that most of us experience in our lives. So, and I promise you, I did not do that for years, and I did not feel loved. I didn't. Quality time, right? Give me your undivided attention. That's another one of my languages, right? Just be with me. Just be with me and make me feel important. Spend time with me so that I know that I matter. Because if you're with me, you don't want to be anywhere else. Well, do I spend quality time with myself? I mean, I'm with myself a lot. That probably constitutes quantity time, don't you think? But do I give myself undivided attention, or is my mind flitting, you know, hither and yon, right? Can I veg quietly on the weekend and not feel guilty? Ooh, there's a big one. See? If undivided attention, me, right? You're with me. If that matters to me and I'm with me and I'm constantly thinking about all the things I have to do that I'm not doing and how guilty I feel that I'm not taking care of business, well, then I'm not making myself feel very loved and appreciated by myself, am I? Okay? So as for food, well, I spent quantity time with food, crappy food most of the time, and it was never about quality or enjoying my time with it. So in other words, it wasn't about love for me at all. See? I mean, if that was truly my love language, wouldn't you think I would have wanted to spend time with quality food? You know? It's kind of odd. So I think that a lot of us struggle to feel loved by ourselves. We do. We struggle with that. And it might be something as simple as not understanding how to speak to yourself in your own love language. So I do encourage you guys. I think this is pretty cool stuff. It can definitely help you in your relationship with yourself, with others, with your spouse, your mate, your significant other, friends, okay, your children, everything. It's very, very important to figure out because a lot of us get frustrated and say, why don't they understand that I love them? Well, they just can't hear. They might as well be deaf or speaking. They might as well be speaking Spanish when you're trying to speak English, okay? I think it's really, really important because we talk about low self-esteem all the time. I mean, that's when I ask you guys what you want to talk about, low self-esteem comes up first and foremost. But guess what? Self-esteem is based on self-worth. So do you feel valuable? Do you feel valued? Do you feel worthwhile? Do you feel capable? Do you feel effective? Okay, well, in order to get there, what is it that makes you feel valuable? What is it, what would you do to show someone else that they have value? Think about that and then figure it and then do it for yourself. What is it that you would do? How would you communicate to make someone feel worthwhile? Would it be, you know, would you give them a big hug? Okay, hug yourself. I didn't used to like to touch myself. I mean, it's just like, ew, my skin is gross, I'm sure of it. I mean, I have flabby skin and I felt, you know, and that's horrible. That's horrible. Okay, so again, if I felt that way about myself, then certainly I didn't want anyone else to touch me either, right? Okay, so we want to look at that stuff and figure out if the language of love, if our love languages, are we able to hear them ourselves from ourselves? Are we able to convey them to others and are other people hearing that we love them as well? Or do they speak another language? I think this is some good homework to start working on, okay? Because, you know, when people hear, yes, you can, you deserve it. Thanks, Leanne. You know, it's really funny. Some people would hear that and that would say, eh, it does nothing. But if I hear that, you deserve it. Ooh, okay, words of affirmation, then that speaks to me in a different way than it might speak to someone else who's all about gifts. It's really funny. One of my daughter's love languages is definitely gifts. Gift giving. Okay, to be honest, I'd rather it be acts of service, but what can you do? You know, like, oh, how sweet of you to do the dishes and clean your room and empty the trash. And okay, but that's not her love language. Her love language, as it turns out, is gift giving. And as a result, I have some fabulous shoes in my closet. So I really can't, and some really cute outfits too. So I really can't complain. But to her, she takes a great deal of time to choose just the perfect thing to give to someone. And guess what? She wants it back. And oh, she gets mad if someone doesn't take the time to give her a gift on her birthday or for Christmas. And to me, it really doesn't matter. I'm like, oh, that's really nice. I couldn't really care if, you know, I don't need anything for my birthday or Christmas. Oh, that's really nice. But I'd rather just make sure that everybody else is having a nice time and feels good. Oh, with her, you might as well be telling her, I hate you, if you don't give her just the right gift, you see? And that's very strong with her, okay? So if gift giving matters to us, well, what is the gift? What is the ultimate gift we could give ourselves but recovery, right? Give yourself the gift of recovery. If gift giving is your language, do that. Quality time, spend quality time working on your recovery. You know, if it's a food addiction problem, go to an OA meeting, you know, Overeaters Anonymous, 12-step, go to Celebrate Recovery, right? Go to your support group meetings. That's quality time. That shows yourself that you matter and that you love yourself enough to take care of your needs lovingly, right? Doesn't that make sense? What do you guys think about this? Does this, I mean, it seems kind of obvious, you know, acts of service. Gosh, take care of yourself. Do something for yourself that you would do for someone else. You know what I did this weekend? I finally sewed up a few, I did some darning, some, you know, on a couple of ripped things. And I've been doing more of that, putting buttons on. And those are acts of service. Okay, now granted, that may not be my primary love language, but I've got to tell you, I feel really good about myself. Very accomplished, because I say, wow, I did that. Okay, I could not thread my own needle, but that's another story. But I'm like, honey, make it really, really long so I don't have to thread it for like a year. So anyway, think about your love language. If you're not sure, go to that site, take that little test, find it out. It's very, very cool. And see if by learning what your love language is, it changes anything with you in your relationship with yourself and with food and wow, recovery. Okay, let's figure that out. So, hi, Lila. I'm so glad you're here. Wow, I haven't seen you in so long. And girl, we need to come see you. My mom needs a haircut. Okay, that's another story. All right. So, anyway, I'm going to leave it there. I'm not going to, like, beat it up because, again, I'm no expert on this stuff. I just wanted to throw it out there and have you guys think about it and then get back to me, okay? And, hey, guess what? Today, if you loved the show, if you love the show, share. That's kind of like a gift you give to somebody. Or maybe you're, you know, like giving somebody, yeah, a little gift, right? An act of service. You're going, you know what? Let me go ahead and handle this. Let me take care of this for you, Carrie, and show you how much I care about you. I'm gonna share your show. And, oh, words of affirmation. I'm going to put a little something in the comment line that says, I really, really enjoy this show, and I hope that you do too. And what's the other one? I don't think we can do anything with touch. But you can reach out and touch somebody by sharing my video. There you go. So anyway, you get the idea, you guys. You get the idea. Focus on, are you showing yourself love in a language that you can understand? Are you speaking a language you can understand? And is that relationship with food hateful or loving? A lot of people say, well, I love food. Do you though? Do you? All right. We will talk more tomorrow for sure. Thank you guys for being here as ever. Give me some suggestions. Somebody talked about drama, family drama. I want to drill down a little bit more on that and get a little bit more feedback talking about what kind of family drama are we talking about? You know, give me some examples. Somebody else mentioned stress eating. When I'm stressed, stress makes me eat. Somebody said, I think it was Marcus. And I hate food. Is that what you just said, Jerry? I know, honey. We'll talk about that later. We'll talk about that later. Anyway, stress doesn't make you eat. You eat as a result of in response to stress. So we could talk about stress. We could talk about all kinds of things, all right? So I'm going to let you guys go at 55 past the hour. Thank you, as always, for being here. Thank you for your wonderful feedback. You know what? Words of affirmation. I'm getting some really nice words of affirmation in Messenger. Thank you so much. It makes me feel really good. It makes me feel loved. So thank you so much. All right. You guys have a wonderful rest of the day. Whenever it is that you're watching this, I will see you all tomorrow. And I'm going to remind you to have courage, seek peace, embrace joy, and above all, lovingly live your recovery. Remember, you can't stop feeding what's eating you if you don't know what's eating you. I will see you guys tomorrow. Take care. Bye.